Haven of Rest Missionary Baptist Church Sunday School Lesson Number 3 for Sunday, June 19, 2016. The lesson is entitled Joy for the Faithful. The lesson comes from Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 9 through 14 and 20. We were asked to read Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 9 through 20. The place is Jerusalem. The time is roughly 625 through 635 BC. In every turn of events in life, it is the Lord who makes a positive difference. His people have been magnified and ridiculed down through the ages. They have reaped the consequences of their wrongdoing. They have suffered at the hands of others. All these negatives are overcome by the grace of God. In our text, we see a perfect example of this. It was not because of their own works of righteousness that God's people were rescued from attacks by other nations or kept from his wrath over their sin. Only by God's grace are any of us ever preserved from ruin and given joy and rejoicing. God renews his people and enables them to once again praise him and delight in holy things. He forgets about their unfaithfulness and blesses them. He wants us to receive his gracious forgiveness and forget about the problems we have caused. Only Satan and human beings carry grudges and exact revenge. Today's aim, facts, to see the extent and fullness of the joy God gives to his people. Principle, to know that receiving his grace and salvation will result in his blessing and great joy daily. Application, to live daily with the mental awareness that God in his grace forgives and restores us. Illustrating the lesson, God's people will be the joy of the entire earth. Today we have two outlines, the blessings for the Gentiles, that comes from Zephaniah 3, 9 through 10, and blessing for the Jews comes from Zephaniah 3, 11 through 14 and 20. The golden text reads, Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout, O Israel, be glad and rejoice with all the heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. Zephaniah 3:14. Introduction. Divine judgment is a recurring theme in the Bible. God's punishments, in fact, play a major role in Old Testament history, from the flood in Noah's time to the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah to the fall of Jerusalem in 586 BC. Yet in times of such judgment, God's grace shines brightly. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, Genesis 6:8, and he and his family were delivered from the flood that took the lives of everyone else on earth. Although God could not find even 10 people in Sodom who were gracious, Genesis 18 through 19, he graciously spared Lot and his family from the utter destruction that fell upon that wicked city. Through the centuries, the Lord repeatedly warned his chosen people of the consequences of their disobedience to his law. His gracious warnings were largely ignored, but even when God's judgment on Judah and Jerusalem was imminent, he gave them a future hope beyond the coming judgment. There is always hope because God is gracious. He freely offers us eternal life, peace, and insurance. He asks only that we trust and obey him. Blessing for the Gentiles. Zephaniah 3:9. For then will I turn to the people, a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent. Verse 10, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering. After more than two chapters of almost unrelenting announcements and descriptions of God's coming judgment upon Judah and the city of Jerusalem, as well as the Gentile nations of the world, the book of Zephaniah ends on a note of grace. Though the promised day of the Lord, the judgment of God, will come, there was still hope beyond that disaster. In Zephaniah 3:8, there was a subtle shift from the coming judgment upon God's people in the fall of Judah and the city of Jerusalem in 586 BC to a still future judgment upon all all the nations. That future judgment will take place in the end times at the end of the Great Tribulation, when Christ returns to earth as conquering king. Revelations 19, 11 through 21. In Zephaniah 3, the time markers then, verse 9, in that day, verse 11, and at that time, verse 20, all speak of the coming day that will follow Christ's return and the judgment of the nations. This marks the beginning of Christ's kingdom reign of 1,000 years. While some have taken these verses as referring to the return of the exiled people of Judah from their 70-year Babylon captivity, Ezra 1, that return does not match what is described in Zephaniah 3. The Lord declared through his prophet that he would turn to the people a pure language, verse 9, in saying he would purify the language or speech of these people. The Lord was saying their hearts too would be purified. Zephaniah 3:10 suggests that those in view in verse 9 are Gentiles or non-Jews. These are people from the nations of the world who will be converted to Christ. While judgment will fall upon the nations, there will be some among them who trust in Christ and be saved. These believers will be given a pure language so that they will call upon the Lord. That is not a new or unique language, but rather purified, uncontaminated speech. The impurity of which they were formerly guilty arose from their swearing by and praying to false gods. In the millennial age, Gentile Christians not only will worship God in word, but also serve him in one accord. This worship and service is seen in the mention of Ethiopia. The Ethiopians were first addressed in Zephaniah 2:12, where they presented the nations to the south that will suffer God's judgment. Here in chapter 3, they seem to represent all the Gentile nations, for they will come from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. Verse 10 brings offerings to God. Some commentators take this verse as referring to dispersed Jewish people coming to the Lord from other nations, bringing their offerings. However, it can simply be taken as people who have been widely dispersed and geographically separated from the center of God's gracious actions in the Promised Land. The purpose of the judgment of the nations is to purify them. With the removal of the vast numbers who oppose God and his program, the believing remnant will come to Jerusalem to worship God. The effect of the conversation of the Gentiles will be to place them in alignment with the purpose of God for Israel in their restoration to Palestine. Even for Christians, the judgment of God is a rather unpleasant subject. No doubt this is because it is very difficult for us to see matters from the perspective of the one who is perfectly holy. Here, however, we see how God's just punishment of the wicked serves his purpose in bringing about a purified remnant who will worship the Lord in holiness. Blessings for the Jews. Verse 11. In that day shalt thou not be ashamed for all thy doings, wherein thou hast transgressed against me. For then I will take away out of the midst of thee them that rejoice in thy pride, and thou shalt no more be haughty because of my holy mountain. 12. I will also leave in the midst of thee an afflicted and poor people, and they shall trust in the name of the Lord. 13. The remnant of Israel shall not do iniquity, nor speak lies, neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth, for they shall feed and lie down, and none shall make them afraid. 14. Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout, O Israel, be glad and rejoice with all the heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. 20. At that time will I bring you again, even in the time that I gather you, for I will make you a name and a praise among all people of the earth, when I turn back your captivity before your eyes, saith the Lord. A humble people. Zephaniah 3. 11. In verse 11, Zephaniah's divinely given message turn to the Jewish people and their condition in that day. Again, that day refers to the dawn of Christ's millennial kingdom, following God's judgment on the nations of the earth, verse 8. As Zephaniah and other prophets foretold, the Jewish people were disseminated by the Babylonians, who leveled Jerusalem, burned the temple, and took the majority of the survivors into captivity in 586 BC. They eventually turned to the land God had promised them, though it was now under control of the Palestinians. Persian control of Palestine was replaced by the Greeks and eventually the Romans, with only a relatively short period of independence. In the first century AD, Jewish revolt, the Romans destroyed the temple, and it has never been rebuilt. The centuries since then have seen the Jewish people dispersed and persecuted like no other people on earth. The establishment of the State of Israel in 1948 gave them a home and a portion of their ancient homeland. There is no temple, however, and only a few among them have put their faith in Christ. The Jewish people have suffered the judgment of God and the hatred of the nations, but through it all, the promise of God to them has remained unchanged. There is hope. When Christ establishes his earthly kingdom, they will all trust in their Messiah and Savior. They will no longer be ashamed of all their deeds, but will be redeemed and forgiven. Those who rejoice in their sinful pride will be gone, and only the godly, redeemed remnant will be present. The history of Israel is a history of the grace and love of God. Even as he disciplines his people, that history is not yet complete, however, and will not be until the nation is redeemed, restored to their land, and serving their Lord. A trusting people, Zephaniah 3:12. The proud people who once inhabited Jerusalem and brought God's displeasure among the nation will be in the kingdom age be replaced by an afflicted and a poor people. This is not a physical description, but a spiritual one. These are humble and lowly people, as opposed to the proud and haughty. They recognize their true need of the Lord and put their trust in him. We rejoice when we hear of Jewish people trusting the Lord today, and there are growing numbers of them. Yet, as a percentage, there are very few who have come to the Messiah. But we can rejoice that God is not through with them. He has not abandoned his promises to them, just as he has not forgotten his promises to us. The promises of God are sure, and one day Israel will be filled with humble people who trust in him and him alone, a righteous people. Zephaniah 3:13. Whereas Israel is often used of the northern kingdom in contrast to the southern kingdom of Judah. Here the word refers to all Jewish people, descendants of Abraham through Jacob, who enter the millennial kingdom of Christ. This, of course, will consist of a remnant of the people. Amazingly, the end time judgments will turn the Jewish people toward their Messiah, with the result that at Christ's coming, all living Israelites will be saved, Romans 11:26. However, these will represent just a small minority of all the Jewish people who have lived since Jacob's time. The believing Israelites in that future day will no longer be the rebellious and wicked people described earlier in Zephaniah. Ezekiel prophesies this very thing about 65 years later, when he wrote a one-time following God's judgment and gave God's promise. A new heart also will I give you, Israel, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them, and ye shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and ye shall be my people, and I will be your God. Ezekiel 36:26-28. God's purpose for Israel will finally be achieved when the nations turn to him in faith. As a result of their spiritual conversion, the Jewish remnant that enters Christ's millennial kingdom will not do iniquity nor speak lies, neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth. The basic meaning of the word translated inequity is to deviate from a right standard, to act contrary to what is right. The Jewish people's continual disregard for God's standards had brought God's judgment upon them. Believing Jews of that future day, however, will not deviate from God's will. Similarly, lies and deceit that characterized their prophets and their priests, as well as the general population, will be removed from their lips. They will finally be the holy people God called them to be. Because of their trust in God and obedience in Him, Israel will enjoy peace and rest in their own land. They shall feed and lie down, and none shall make them afraid. In a picture reminiscent of Psalms 23, they will be like sheep that are led by the great shepherd and will graze and feed and lie down to rest in no fear of predators. Despite their inglorious past, a glorious future awaits Israel, but it will come only because of the immeasurable grace of God. He has chastised, pleaded, and waited, not willing that all should come to repentance. God's amazing grace towards wayward Israel should give us a great appreciation for His grace toward us. When we were dead in sin, we deserve nothing but His judgment. Yet by His grace, God has raised us up to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He is worthy of our eternal praise, a rejoicing people. Zephaniah 3:14. The call to rejoice is appropriate in view of both what God has promised and the future details in the succeeding verses. Even as the Lord announced the inevitable judgment, He let His people know that He had not forgotten or abandoned them. The trouble that lay ahead was not to be the last chapter in Israel's history. His grace assured them of a bright future when they will fully follow Him, and He will bless them as He has always desired. He will take away their judgments, defeat their enemies, and dwell among them. The exhortation to rejoice seems to be addressed to the future Israelites who experience the millennial blessings. However, because God's promises are certain of fulfillment, even the few faithful in Judah in Zephaniah's time could rejoice. Daughter of Zion, Israel, and daughter of Jerusalem are all synonyms set forth poetically in Zephaniah 3:14 to emphasize the point the Lord was making. Likewise, sing and shout and be glad and rejoice also convey the same idea. They speak of heartfelt rejoicing, not over anything that have done, but over the gracious work of God in delivering and blessing them. It is safe to say that the redeemed Israel that day will fully obey this call. Praise among all people. Zephaniah 3:20. Zephaniah's prophecy, which began with an announcement of judgment, ends with words of eternal hope. Christ will reign on earth as king, and His redeemed Jewish subjects will be gathered from across the globe to Jerusalem to serve Him in peace, safety, and holiness alongside Gentile believers of all ages. The promise God made 2,000 years before Christ's first coming to make Abraham's descendants a great nation, give them a land, and make them a blessing will be fulfilled. Genesis 12:1-3. Israel will be restored to her land, given honor, and made a praise among all people of the earth. Those who saw the fall and destruction of Jerusalem in 586 BC had only one reason to believe such future blessings could ever be possible: the promise of God. The circumstances of the moment are intrusive, but it is the word of the living, all-powerful God that is infallible and can be trusted regardless of what the world around us looks like. The Bible alone is a reliable guide for our lives and the only sure source of knowledge concerning what the future holds. Questions. What time period is referred to in Zephaniah 3:9, 11, and 20? 2. To what group of people do verses 9 through 10 refer? 3. What is the ultimate purpose of God's judgment on the nations? 4. What will be different about the Jewish people at that time? Verse 11, and why? 5, in what sense will the future people of Jerusalem be afflicted and poor? Verse 12. 6, to whom does the term Israel refer in verse 13? 7, how will the end time judgments affect the Jewish people? 8, what picture does Zephaniah employ to depict the future conditions of Israel? 9, why did the Lord exhort to rejoice? Why? 10, what promise to Israel is seen as fulfilled in verse 20? This concludes our Sunday school lesson for June 19th, 2016. Thank you for listening. God bless.